everybody. Welcome back from lunch. And we will continue with the politicisation of mathematics and biography in the 20th century. We've got three slide shorts, 20 minutes, so I shall be gesticulating wildly 5 minutes before the June. We have Chris Hollings from the Queen's College, Oxford, reading Between the Lines, Soviet Mathematical Biography. Chris.
Thank you. I would like to start by definitely thanking the organisers for arranging this conference, which I enjoy enormously. And I also perhaps should begin with a slight apology, which is that there is something a little bit vague and impressionistic about the things I'm going to say. I think there's something interesting there, and I was trying to pin it down, so hopefully I can convince you that there's something of interest here, if I can find the right words. My concern, as you can see, is the particular style in which biographers and mathematicians are written in Soviet publications, and there's a great range of publications that covered, that carried biographies and so on. But I'm going to focus in particular on the journal Respekhi Mathematicheski Progress of the Mathematical Sciences, which was founded in the early 1930s. It continues to this day, carries survey articles, conference reports, biographies, obituaries, the occasional research paper, but that's not its main focus. And in the work that I've done on Soviet mathematicians, this is my go-to place for biographies of people. And having read quite a lot of them, I started to notice there's a pattern, there's a way in which these are put together. So that's what I'm trying to have a look at here. So just to give you an idea of what I'm talking about, I give here one example, which I'll pull apart so that I can show you what I mean. You'll notice it's in English. That's because Uspekhi has been translated into English as Russian Mathematical Survey since the late 60s. So I can have put an English version of the biography up here. The picture, I should say, comes from Mac Tutor. Mac Tutor illustrates many of my talks. So this is the full extent of the two pages on this guy against the who's someone I've been interested in. And you see this is an article that appeared on his on the occasion of his 50th birthday. Okay, so what does it consist of then? Well, first of all, there is a one sentence introductory paragraph which just sets the scene in the most basic way possible. The eminent Soviet algebraist and professor at Leningrad Pedagogical Institute, B.S.C. Arpin, had his 50th birthday on September the 19th, 1964. So, simple as that. We then have the basic facts paragraph, where he was born, where he studied, and so on and so forth. We then have an account of his activities during the Great Patriotic War, or the Second World War, for the rest of us. Then there's some mathematics, which continues over onto the next page, and of course that makes up the bulk of the article. Perhaps not surprising, these are articles that were aimed at mathematicians, so there's a focus on the mathematics. We've got a bit about his teaching activities at the bottom, and there's also one of the concluding paragraphs is what I call the usefulness to the state paragraph, which tells us about the various committees that he sat on and official activities that he's undertaking. So that's how I unpick this biography. And this is a biography, this is a structure that is common to all of these biographies. I'd say that it's a perfectly reasonable structure. There's nothing remarkable about the structure in itself. What is remarkable, I think, is the fact that it's just repeated as the standard format. So here it is. It's always a one-sentence introductory paragraph, very much of that style. It gives the person's name, and the work and the reason for the article. Never longer than one sentence, always one sentence. We have basic facts that cover birthplace, social background, very important feature, education, dissertations written, place of work, If the subject is of an appropriate age, you will have the obligatory passage about the Great Patriotic War. And then there's the mathematical work part of the article. The other parts around it are of a fairly fixed length, the sort of the paragraphs of the sort of size that we have there. What varies enormously, though, is the section on the mathematical work, and this is what really determines the length of the article, whether it be a short one like the one I just showed you, or a substantially longer one, as the subject sometimes appears. As I pointed out before, you have the teaching activities paragraph, which will often tell you that they supervised N research students, they've written N textbooks. And there's a great emphasis on the way in which this person has been a positive influence on the next generation of Soviet scholars. So that then will blur into the usefulness to the state section. So as I said, that's committees, local government activities, as some people were involved in, and often awards and honours. So a great many mathematicians in the Soviet Union were awarded the Order of Lenin for their work. There's also the title of Honored Scientist of the Russian Federation, and things like that will often appear in this bit as just as a list. And in fact, with the possible exception of the section on mathematical work, these are biographies that all could almost be written as a series of bullet points. They are very fact-based things. They are they're very impersonal things. You won't find anything here at all about family. Unless it's in a sentence telling you about the humble origins of the subject. okay, so that's the general structure to these things. And then there's a matter of looking at what information is there in each particular instance. So just to go back to what I had about the argument, I noted social background here in the basic facts paragraph. Well, I probably shouldn't have done that for Mark Yarping because it doesn't say anything about his social background. His social background was of the wrong type. He was a child of the St. Petersburg intelligentsia, if you put it that way. So that's just not mentioned at all. That's omitted completely. It's the post-Soviet biographies that tell us these sorts of things. So there's sort of an interesting way of gaining more information about a person is to look at the biographies written during the Soviet period and look at the post-Soviet ones, which of course we're doing in Yarmkin's case. More of a problem for people who didn't outlive the Soviet Union. But I should say that these post-Soviet ones are still very much of this very largely impersonal sort of style, so that you using these sources you rarely get anything other than a two-dimensional picture of these people. You have to look to other materials for that. So in fact, to pick up on a point that was made yesterday about whether you come to love or loathe the people that you are researching, in most cases you never really get that far with this because you find out so little about them. Okay, so other things, yes, usefulness to the state. This is the place where in many of these sorts of biographies we would proudly be told that this person has served so many years as a member of the Communist Party. No such detail in Yarmkin's case because he consistently refused to join the Communist Party and there were consequences to his career because of that. But of course we don't find that here, we find that in the post-Soviet biographies. So this is a sort of links with the comment we had earlier about what can you tell from the holes that are other in biographies. So we have these sort of the two sources, the pre and post Soviet types of biography, and the things you have to watch out for, if that's the right way of phrasing it, is the omissions. It's the things that are missing. What's there is usually correct insofar as it goes, but it's the omissions. And that's true of various sources, not just these specky articles. So this is another thing that I just pulled out because I find this a very useful resource. This is a Soviet biographical directory, much like Poggendorf, those of you who know the Poggendorf directory. So at the top we have Anton Sushkevich, who is another archaeologist I've been interested in. It tells you where he was born, where he studied, where he as a professor, completely omits the fact that he studied in Germany. That's just gone completely. And also in connection with this issue of what name do you, what countries do you assign to people, what name do you give it, it does say that he graduated from Leningrad University in 1913. Of course, there's no such place as Leningrad in 1913. So there's more omissions. Slightly more sinister thing in the bottom one, where we do actually have a factual error. Mikhail Orlov, who really wasn't much of a mathematician, but was more of a mathematical ideologue. We have his dates there, 1897 to 1944, while in fact he was executed in 1936. So you do have to be careful with these things. Mostly it's omissions, but occasionally there are sort of factual things like that. Okay, so the question is, what can I do with this? This is just something I've noticed having read lots of these biographies. And I have a couple of ideas of where to go, or how this might be useful. So this is a name that might be known to many of you, Nikolai Luzin, who's a Moscow function theorist. He is most famous now. If you've heard of him, you've probably heard of him because of the Luzin affair in 1936, which was a political attack on him. And he was summoned before a special commission of the Academy of Sciences and accused of all manner of things, including plagiarism, sending his best work abroad, and encouraging his students to do likewise, and thus infecting the minds of the next generation with the wrong ideas and so on. And this was very much a flash in the pan. It was several days in July 1936. The commission made a decision which resulted in a much more lenient punishment for Luzin than was originally expected. He was simply dismissed from official positions, and he continued to work as a mathematician, and nobody spoke of this again for a very long time. So if you look to the biographies, he disappears from these biographies. You don't have biographies for, say, his 50th birthday. That's not something that appears, but he does then begin to appear once again in these journals. There are biographies of him. Naturally, they don't say anything about the Luzin affair, but as you read your way from one to the next, you begin to see that there are hints of something there. They're very oblique references to something having happened in the mid-30s. And so I thought this might be an interesting angle to pursue in looking at sort of general knowledge of what had happened. It would be a mystery that people really didn't talk about. Another point or angle that I might pursue comes from a very different place. The man on the left here, Nikolai Kamenin, who's not a mathematician, but a pilot, great hero of the Soviet Union, because he was involved in the rescue of the Chelyuskin survivors. The Chelyuskin was an icebreaker which attempted to navigate across the North Pole, got into difficulties, and got stuck in the ice. Broke up and sank, and the crew was stranded on the ice, and there was a big rescue effort, and Kamenin was the lead pilot in this, and he became a hero. 20 years later, he became the head of cosmonaut selection and training. And the cosmonauts, of course, were great public figures, and they had official biographies written of them, and they were all based very closely on Kamenin's own autobiography, so it stressed the important things like humble origins and had all the right words like heroic struggle and the building of socialism and all that kind of thing. And so some people have been studying the way in which these ghost-written biographies of cosmonauts were written based on his autobiography in this very standardized way, and I'm wondering if there's something in that study that can inform this way that biographies of mathematicians were put together. I think as far as the general public is concerned, mathematicians are not such as heroic figures as cosmonauts, but I think there's something to be looked into there. Well, just one final comment to finish. Does anybody recognize the figure on the right? No. I was very happy to find this picture, because this is Otto Schmidt, who was the captain of the Chelyuskin, for one thing. But as well as being an Arctic explorer and quite a successful mid-level Soviet politician. He was also a group theorist. He is the Schmidt of the Schmidt-Remak theorem. And he's a very interesting figure. The second edition of his monograph on abstract groups, he signs off the preface as from the Bridge of the Chernyuski. And so he's a nice contrast with which to end the talk, because we're sort of drunk with information about him. It's very difficult to find out things about other people. But there's lots to be said about him. I say he's a fascinating figure. But that's another talk in time. So we'll stop there.
Thank you, Chris.
I've seen any of biographies of this type for female mathematicians. I've seen Kovalevskaya ones, and they are of a very different type, more like the sort of thing that you were talking about. But when it comes to this very formulaic way of doing things, I honestly can't remember ever having seen any of it.
Because in a way she lends herself to it, due to this whole nihilism thing. And on the other hand, I will talk to you.
you contrasted post-Soviet with Soviet, but do you see sort of evolution in the way they happened during the Soviet era? Are there distinctions or any sort of periodization there?
Not really. I think I could convince myself that there is something a little freer about them after Stalin's death. I don't want to go so far as to say candid, because they're definitely not candid biographies, but you feel like they're... Yeah, there's more willingness to put in details about where they come from, even if it's not quite the right sort of background. But that's... I don't know whether that's a pattern or whether it's something I've imposed on.